Bradley, and welcome to the Dread Strategic Commissioning Board. Cllr Bernie Mooney has been held up and she's on the way. I don't know. Right. I don't know whether we're expecting anybody else at the moment. Shall we just go around the table and introduce ourselves? I'm Councillor Chris Jones, I'm the co-chair of this committee, and I'm chairing today.
Hello, I'm Sue Wells, I'm the other co-chair of this committee, and I'm the chair of Wirral CCG.
Just a reminder to people, if you want to be on camera, press the button and you get the red light up and turn your on. So I'm Simon Banks, I'm Chief Officer of World Health and Care Commissioner.
Graham Hawkinson, Director of Care and Health.
Sean Stays, from the Long Term Conditions of the CCG.
I'm Mike Trout, Chief Finance Officer of the CCG.
Jason Oxley, Assistant Director of Health and Care at Rural Health and Care Commissioning.
I'm Donna Dean, Interim Programme Manager for Rural Health and Care Commissioning.
You get to come round. I'm Paul, the Town Director Court Person for Rural Health and Care Commissioning.
Good afternoon, I'm Lorna Quigley, Director of Quality and Safety.
Thank you everybody. I'm sure we'll get used to the microphones. Thank you for the reminder, Simon. It's very kind. Any apologies for absence? That's Mr. Stuart, isn't it? Anybody else? Members' Code of Conduct. Councillor Stuart, have you got any declarations of interest? I'll declare an interest as an employee of CWP in case anything specific comes up. I hope everybody's read the minutes of the last meeting. This is slightly different for our two bodies who are coming together. So whereas the council, the councillors actually make their decisions at the meeting, the CCG take everything back to the full board. So Sue, would you like to?
Thank you, Councillor Jones. On this occasion, we are poorer as a governing body, so are able to make decisions on behalf of the governing body.
So from the last minutes, can you just tell us what happened?
Yep. So thank you. Just a point of accuracy, Simon Banks is noted twice, and I'm not noted, whereas I was present. On the recommendations that were taken back to the governing body, all three of the recommendations were approved by our full governing body, so can we take those decisions off the governing body?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Sue. So is everybody happy that I signed the minutes off from the last meeting? Simon?
Just the term the NHS Wirral should be the NHS Wirral CCG members. As that is the statutory recommendation.
Have you got that? Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah. I remember being present at the last meeting myself.
You were.
I'm not noting the minutes. I suppose that I'll have to impact.
So with those alterations then, so the first thing on our agenda is Joint Strategic Commissioning Board is the Liverpool City Region Complex Cape Greenwood. That's Jason.
Chair. So this report describes the proposal to enter into a Liverpool City Region complex care provider framework. The report seeks approval from Joint Strategic Commissioning Board to commence a procurement exercise to support the creation of a single Liverpool City Region flexible purchasing system. And this is for care and support services for adults with complex needs. This system will be made available to the six Liverpool City Region councils and also the NHS clinical commissioning groups where appropriate who operate across the Liverpool City Region. The framework will support the Wirral plan, the pledges within the plan and the Healthy Wirral plan, and particularly around the pledges in relation to people with disability living independently. The recommendations are that the Joint Strategic Commissioning Board approve the creation of the Liverpool City Region Complex Care Framework for use by Rural Health and Care Commissioning and the Liverpool City Region Councils, depending on their decision making processes, and also to approve authority to Rural Health and Care Commissioning to procure and award the contracts for care and support services alongside with the proposed framework. In terms of some background, the Liverpool City Region Strategic Leadership Board is established and has identified a significant potential for Liverpool City Region Councils, of which Wirral is one, to commission services for adults with complex care needs in a much more collaborative manner than we do currently. It's envisaged that greater collaboration across the areas in partnership with local CCGs will facilitate improvements in both service quality and efficiency across complex care provision. We have engaged initially with the provider markets, and the provider organisations are broadly very positive about these proposals. Whilst there is a robust and effective commissioning practice across all local areas at the moment, the development of a more collaborative approach will achieve opportunities for us. The lack of a regional collaboration approach at the moment has led to a marketplace where each council and CCG has different specifications, different contracts, and as a result, different monitoring and performance management arrangements in each local area. In addition, there are different ranges of rates being paid to providers that provide similar services across the patch. This is an inefficient way of operating currently, and it creates challenges and unnecessary administration, particularly around duplication bureaucracy, where both commissioners and providers are duplicating the work required. To illustrate this, there are approximately 500 providers for complex care, providing residential and community care services across Liverpool City Region at the moment, with an average weekly spend of over £7 million. Many providers are commissioned across multiple council areas, and for example, the four largest supported living providers have a presence in all of the six councils, and they therefore have to attend to work in all different commissioning arrangements in each of those areas. So this proposal supports the Transforming Care Programme, which as we know is a national programme designed to improve health and care services for people with learning disability and autism so that more people can live in the community with the right support and closer to home. This Transforming Care Programme has three main priorities: to improve the quality of care for people with a learning disability and or autism, to improve quality of life for people, and to enhance community capacity, thereby reducing inappropriate hospital admissions and length of stay. So this commissioning framework proposal would support those aims. The Care Act also places a duty on local authorities around well-being and to help people to live as independently as possible. Specific duties in the Care Act relate to supporting a sustainable market and a more personalised approach to assessment and support, which again this proposal would support. So this commissioning framework will create a single entry point for the six councils and CCG partners to commission services and a single route for providers to register to supply services across that patch. The framework will remain open so that new providers can join as the market evolves and develops. This will maximise the level of choice that people have when choosing services in line with their assessed needs, because there will be a more cohesive and transparent range of services available to meet those needs. Within scope for this framework, we have largely working age adults with disability and mental health needs. This doesn't rule out the fact that people with disabilities live into older life and also children and young people go through transition, but it's targeted at working age adults with complex needs. Particularly for people with learning disability, autism, mental health conditions, acquired brain injury, physical disability, or dual diagnosis. The range of complex care needs that we'd expect it to cover. Listed in the report is the proposed service areas that this will cover, the types of services which I won't go through now. I think I would just like to highlight some of the anticipated benefits that this would bring for us. So it would reduce duplication, it would help us to combine knowledge and expertise and data around service providers. We would have a more strategic market facilitation and engagement and oversight of quality improvement. This would promote personalisation and would help to maximise choice and control of people using services. In terms of the time scale for this, the procurement exercise would be in late October, possibly into early November. Evaluations would be completed during winter, and the new framework would be implemented subject to approval in February 2019. To transition to the new arrangements, existing services would be unaffected. There will be no disruption to people's existing services that they receive. Providers who would be registered on the framework would also be registered on Liverpool Wirral, so that would improve the information offered to local residents. In terms of financial implications, there are very few financial implications here, because this framework helps us to streamline commissioning processes, but it doesn't commit us to contracting in terms of volumes or with particular providers. In terms of the cost, it's largely simply the facilitation of administering the framework itself. So proportionally, based on a per capita basis for Wirral, this would be an initial first year setup of about £6,500 and an ongoing running cost of just over £2,000. This doesn't affect fee rates that are currently approved for Wirral, so it's not about the fee rates. In terms of engagement and consultation, we have had significant engagement with providers who have responded very positively to these proposals. Providers see a benefit in terms of them having to make their arrangements through a single gateway rather than with six different local authorities. We do have some proposals to consult with service users where that's appropriate to do so. So, the board will be requested to consider the recommendations.
Thank you very much, Jason. Hello, how much work has been going on around this?
Can you put your microphone on, please? Thank you.
Sorry, thank you, Mrs. Brace. I know how much work has been going on around this, and we really appreciate that. Any questions or comments? Anybody? It obviously makes absolute common sense to everybody, Jason, but thank you very much. So, from the councillor's point of view, are we happy to accept the recommendations?
Yeah,
unanimous. So I'll hand over to Sue.
Thank you. Could the governing body members suggest whether they are happy with the recommendations, which is to approve joining the creation of the LCR framework and give authority to Royal Health and Care Commissioners to procure and award contracts.
Yes.
Thank you, that's approved.
Thank you very much. Our next item is the Healthy Rural Programme Memorandum of Understanding. Over to you, Simon.
So I'm putting that out Patton as Senior Responsible Officer for Healthy Wirral at this point. Healthy Wirral is the programme that aligns itself to the Wirral Plan for 2020. The vision is to enable people in Wirral to live longer and healthier lives by taking simple steps to improve their own health and well-being, and brings together the organisations across the system to work to do that, to bring together the acute trusts, bringing in also in terms of the neighbourhood model, the voluntary sector as well, and has brought together us as commissioning organisations as well. It's the prime system-wide programme to develop sustainable and affordable long-term changes in the way health and well-being is delivered for the world population and how it's supported. The programme has been going probably with some gusto for about 12 months now, reinvigorated for the last 12 months or so. We have an independent chair of the programme, which is David Eva. David is a local resident and also formerly the chair of Cheshire Wirral Partnership. David oversees the work. I work with him in that capacity, and there's a small programme team of two other people alongside that. The Healthy Wirral Partners Board have already agreed ways of working. There is a memorandum, there's a terms of reference which we have agreed to work to, and a structure below that, a governance structure, including delivery groups and Healthy Wirral programmes of work, I think are actually outlined in the paper as well. The memorandum of understanding basically takes that to the next footing, where we have all said we're going to do things in together about working as one, about looking at achieving service sustainability, about improving the quality of care, but also doing so in a way that delivers better value, and delivering the programmes we've agreed to, and the memorandum of understanding is that next step. I'm presuming that members have read the report and draw their attention to the recommendations therein.
Thank you, Simon. Any questions or comments? I'd like to say that within our own areas, we've got all obviously been discussing the background, and this is a really important point, I think, isn't it? In Healthy Wirral, the fact that people are actually now determined to get on and do it. So, from a council point of view, then, are we happy to accept the recommendations in number two?
Yes,
unanimous.
So, could governing body members indicate whether they're happy to be a signatory to this memorandum of understanding?
Thank you very much. The next item on our agenda is the Rural Health and Care Commissioning Community Fund Arrangements. I think, Graham, you'd like to say a few words first.
Yes, I thought it would be helpful to the board to. Thank you, Sean. I thought it would be helpful to the board to provide some background comments prior to Michael going through the report, if necessary. The context of this paper is that integration is all about joining up services and planning together where this makes sense. So we want people to be able to navigate through what is a very complicated system. We want them to be able to tell their story only once. We want to reduce delays so that people get the right care in the right place at the right time. And then we want to make sure that there isn't duplication and gaps in services which people can fall through. Equally, we don't want people to get lost in the system, which is something that's happened in the past. So integration is very much about how health and care services are delivered to individuals. This paper focuses on the arrangements that were put in place to join the leadership of health and care commissioning. The Integrated Commission of Health and Care, which is where Health and Care Commission has been in place since May 2018, and the role of Health and Care Commission is to lead the planning and commission of health and care services to a single organisation. And through that, fulfilling the statutory health and care functions of the council and the clinical commissioning group in one place. The arrangements that we put in front of you in terms of the section 75 about the legal agreement that enables that to happen and enables those frontline services to deliver in a legal and joined up way. So, in terms of the section 75 that you've been asked to sign, it is for 2018-19 only. It's for this financial year. And it builds upon the section 75 agreements that have been in place for several years since 2015. The Better Care Fund has been the primary area of work that's been pooled and has enabled us to develop intermediate care services, reablement services, and other services that enable people to get out of hospital or to be supported to not have to go into hospital in the first place with rapid response type services. So very important that's been going for some time. So this agreement in essence provides the background and the agreement for us to operate in the way that we do, but it also brings those things together. So the value of the Better Care Fund was previously 53.7 million. In this year it's over 130 million, and that's because we brought together services around people with complex disabilities, some of which we referred to in Jason's paper earlier on, and public health contracts, as well as some of the support that goes to children with complex disabilities. So when the board are looking at the papers and see all the various services, that's how they make up. Within the paper, it sets out an aim to fully pool resources across the CCG and council care services. However, it is clear that there are a number of issues to be dealt with before any further growth in the pool of resources can be considered. Further scrutiny of the risks as well as the benefits needs to happen. And at this stage, we do not know what the settlement for adult social care will be. And we do not know at this stage what funding for the NHS next year is going to be or what the outturn of the current situation will be. So, in addition to that, there has been concerns expressed from a number of sources in terms of the approach and how we're getting about things. So, in essence, today we're only being asked to sign or to agree to the arrangements for 18-19. And what I would propose is that there's a pause in terms of consideration of any further pooling whilst further scrutiny takes place and further forthcoming funding is agreed.
Ben, can you, sorry, Graham, could you just talk a little bit about the PwC report?
Okay.
Because so, I think that's been one of the issues.
So a number of elements within this report setting out the arrangements. There's a section 75, which is the legal agreement that I referred to. In addition to that, what we've got is a fully published report from PricewaterhouseCoopers. They came, were commissioned by us to do a due diligence exercise. The aim of that due diligence exercise was to set out the benefits and the risks of pool funds and resources. So what they did is they did that in some detail for us. That was considered prior to the cabinet decision to move forward with pooling funds and to create the entity which is Rural Health and Care Commissioning. We have had further consideration as Rural Health and Care Commissioning of the risks and mitigations that they set out, and these have been included at the back of the paper that you have in your pack. I think it's fair to say that some of the language used by PwC when they first came in relation to accountable care organisations and accountable care systems, is something that has not been adopted within Wirral. Whilst they use that language, it is not our language. Our focus is on integrated care, on collaboration, and NHS providers working together. It is not on the creation of an accountable care organisation. I state that categorically.
It's clear that Section 75 has been confirmed some time. It was always the vehicle by which central government saw partnership work and collaborative work across the local authority and health service to ensure care was joined where possible and resources were used in the right way. Section 3.3 tells you on page 2, following key features, integration, pooling resources, intelligence and planning capacity, learning the right care, right place, right time, managing demand and reducing cost of care, clear government arrangements and prerequisites for Section 75, and resilience and flexibility to urgent issues in service delivery. So, appendix 1 in your pack shows the structure of healthy rural in terms of the 6 primary care programs. It's what is referred to probably as the blockbuster diagram, showing the 6 key areas. It's plan care, mental health, neighbourhoods, learning, schools, growing, children, urgent care, and then the 11 enabling programs and 4 shaping programs set out in the appendix 1. Appendix 2 looks at the governance arrangements on one page. The service says, well, integrated commission, partnerships, and integrated provision. Again, it's important to be clear that we are still 2 statutory bodies. So the local authority is a statutory body, and the CCG is a statutory body, and that's why we have these arrangements where we sign off. Jointly at the same time, but actually separate on the sign off. Section 3.7 sets out the rules of executive group that manages the day-to-day delivery of the funds and schemes and overview of the use of the fund. Joint Strategic Commission will obviously have oversight in terms of its role and the decisions made within that. And then section or appendix 3 is the full section 75 agreement, which has come together with a lot of hard work from the legal team, the council, Paul, and all the solicitors in terms of making sure that the right arrangements are put in place, that they are legally binding in terms of that, and actually they fit section 75 agreement as set out. In terms of the PwC due diligence report, it's probably fair to say some context about that. If you engage some due diligence, they often see risks everywhere. It's important to say there is no risk-free option on any of this, but I think the way things were set out in that report initially was feeling that, well, the CCG has a historical deficit, and therefore that deficit will be brought into the pool fund, reducing the money available. That isn't the case. The NHS funding for CCG changed. So some years ago, if the CCG had a deficit, there was an automatic top slice from the following year's allocation. They changed that because they recognised with the pressures on the health service finance between CCGs that actually would create more problems as going forward. So a lot of those to be dealt with, and similarly with the risks of interference with the local authority funding and everything else. If you look at section 3.11, the major risks identified were budget setting. So is there sufficient resource? And I guess from the chair from both sides, would there be cost shunting or risk transference at the expense of either reduced social care money or reduced health service money in terms of the fund social care? How would the management of future demand be given that constantly social care is under pressure? The NHS is under significant pressure from increasing non-elective admissions and other demands. Significant challenges in respect of delivering efficiency savings and obviously managing of historic deficits that I've talked about. So Appendix 5 moves some of that on. And if you refer to Appendix 5, it's quite important really by way of assurance to look at the appendix there to say, well, the far left-hand column identified initial risk with a potential impact, a risk scoring, so a few greens, most ambers, and a few reds. And the far right-hand side tells you where we think you are now, given what I just described in terms of the mitigations and the changes in the allocation process of CCGs. You'll see from the far side, there are no reds. We believe the risks are well mitigated. We will recognise, I think, as we have done, that this arrangement is 18-19. We would intend to increase the CCG allocation into the pool fund going forward. But clearly, when we look at that, it needs to be taken in the new light of a different risk sharing, because currently it's 50-50, which is probably right. We will need a more sophisticated risk share arrangement going forward to understand fully the risks as we come to the UN in terms of budget performance, and also what new money is coming into both social care and the NHS settlement. So I refer you to section 3.16 and page 5. So the expenditure areas that goes into the £129.9 million. We would propose sham arrangements that are set out in section 3.17, which is about £26.3 million. And going towards, as I said, 19-20, we would want to have a look in the next 3 to 5 months at how this arrangement might work. There are quite a few examples nationally, for example, Tameside and other areas that are a few years ahead of us in terms of these arrangements. So it's not necessarily about reinventing the wheelchair, it's about actually looking at arrangements that will suit the Wirral and make sure we get the best for residents and public and patients. Transfer users have set out also section 5.1. The detail is from 5.4 on in terms of budget forecast where we think we are currently. Each pool fund partner, I have to say again, is a statutory organisation in its own right and will need to be compliant with their own financial regimes and statutory duties. I think it's important to emphasise that, because we are entering into risk share or expansion, extension of previous section 75 agreements, and we still have to meet our own statutory financial duties. Section 5.10, we set out the financial risks and challenges, so I think we've been through some of this previously. At this point in time, we are facing in a CCG of 5.6 million net risk against a control total of £2 million surplus. People remember that in order to deliver the £2 million surplus, we have to deliver 19.6 million of savings. It's a very big ask. That's virtually double what we've achieved in previous or last year, £10 million. So there are risks around that delivery of the control total for 18-19. And similar section 5.12 sets out some pressures and mitigations against the local authority challenges, 1.5 of risks and 1.3 million of mitigations. I don't think I've got much more to add, Chair. I'm happy to take questions in terms of the numbers or human beings.
Thank you very much, Mike. Any questions? So, yes, Bernie.
Just a comment. I'm really pleased that we halted things for going forward until we've had more scrutiny. The situation to date has been scrutinised on a number of occasions, and there's notes and minutes for everybody to follow online, and all the mitigation that's all the scrutiny that's taken place to get us to the position that we've got to now. We've had dozens and dozens and dozens of meetings to get us to the position we are in now. But going forward, that's not as clear. So, and there are risks. So from the council point of view, from our perspective, we're delighted that there's going to be a and delighted that it's going to go through council scrutiny as well as other scrutiny committees before we get to the position we're in now in the future. So we need to know that any position that we move to in the future is on solid ground. So that has to be stated. We won't take part in anything that's to do with an ACO. We will not take part in anything to do with privatisation of the NHS. We've said that right the way along as we've gone along. And I'll say it again, and I'm sure both my colleagues will say that as well. The language that was used in the PwC report is very, very, very unfortunate and very, very, very misleading. Because that's not what we want, that's not what we want to be a part of. And I think there is a lot of other examples for the council that have taken this forward and done it successfully in the way we do. I think it's going to be really, really handy if we have comparisons as we go forward of this being done successfully. So I think that will be useful because people seem to think we're the only one in the whole world is doing this and we're selling ourselves to the devil. It seems to be the impression that's been given, which is not what's happening. So I just want to confirm that this has been scrutinised through the whole scrutiny process of the council to get to the position that we're in now. And before we go forward with anything else, it will be scrutinised. And I said we wouldn't put our name in, and then my colleagues won't put our names or anything that hasn't been scrutinised properly, and that we understand properly.
Thank you, Bernie. Yes, Sue.
Thanks, that's very helpful, Mike and Bernie. Just want to say on behalf of the governing body that absolutely for us this is about integrating care for people. It's absolutely not about pushing forward any kind of privatisation in any way.
Thanks, Steve. Thank you, Steve. Anybody else? I'd like to echo Bernie's comments, really. I've been a nurse in the health service. My 40th anniversary was last Monday. And thank you. But the absolute last thing that I would ever be involved with is privatisation. The NHS for me has got to be is free at the point of need and the point of care, the best quality care and social care that we can give to people. And I wouldn't put my name to anything that I didn't believe was the right thing to do. We've worked long and hard as a council, CCG, health partners, the voluntary sector, to work together to try and work out some of the financial difficulties we are all in. And for me, this is really important, looking at some of the contracts that we're looking at, things like weight management. Previously, the council, public health we've moved over into the council from health. We're looking at certain parts of the weight management contract and the CCG we're looking at another. We can now have one contract using the public health intelligence to work out the best things that we can do for the people of Wirral. I'm really pleased that public health are going to be involved in all the contracts. You know, things that this is a really important step, and we're not going to rush into anything too quickly. Some of the issues has been around looking at bed-based services. We are not going to jump into that. We will scrutinise and we will look at every step that we move forward. So I'm very pleased with this, and I would like to ask my council colleagues, are you happy with the recommendations in number two? And they are that the board endorses and supports the approach taken to mitigate the financial risk and to recommend that the Section 75 agreement for 2018 and 19, and that's all this recommendation is for, is agreed for sign off by chief officers on behalf of NHS, Wirral CCG and Wirral Council. Agreed. Unanimous.
Thank you. Can I ask the governing body members equally to look at the recommendations and ask if they are approved? Agreed. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm sure we'll have to pass this to get to the end. Next is parenting strategy and pathway. That's okay.
what he said. To take the allowance of my time on my computer.
No,
thank you. And this is Paul. Thank you, Paul. Oh,
thank you, Chair. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to bring this paper to the board. The reason why this has been brought here is because there is a need within Wirral for us to create a worldwide approach to supporting the parents, which also describes much more clearly how parents can better access parental support when they need it the most. So the paper outlines the current state and the rationale for work that needs to be done on a multi-agency basis to create a clear common approach to parenting that will improve the experiences of families who need that support, as well as give the agencies that are currently providing those services the opportunity to create a common approach and to use the resources that we've got in a more effective way. So the report does actually, in section 2, make a recommendation which I'll come back to. Just by way of background, the current state is that parenting support offered to families has been developed over time out with there being a clear strategy. So what we've now got is that we've got services that have been created to meet emerging needs, which have not always been linked into the availability of support services for families. So many services for children and families have struggled, I think, to be sustainable for all kinds of reasons, partly through budget pressures, which have led to, ironically, services being more difficult to access for families, but also because there hasn't been a thoughtful process behind a way of organising services. Parenting support programmes are really helpful because they're done well in a timely manner. They give parents the capacity, the skills, the time to enable them to better meet the needs of their children. So it's really important that we get this right. There's been extensive mapping of existing provision carried out within the borough, and section 3.4 in bullet points highlights some of the difficulties that we've now got as a result of the way in which services are currently organised. So there's a lack of coordination, complexities around service access, access criteria. Some services only run periodically when there's resources available. There are some provisions which have got waiting lists, there's limited capacity, and there's a real shortage of provision for parents who've got children of secondary age, secondary school age, which causes them problems. So in summary, we've got waiting lists in some services, some courses not operating at full capacity, some parents not able to engage or disengage, and some of the programmes that we provide have got low completion rates, and therefore low impact. By having a strategy, we can tackle all those problems. And creating a collaborative approach, again, section 3.6, it's highlighted again in bullet form what the benefits would be of working together to create a comprehensive way forward. And I won't label the definition that people have read the report. So, in summary, what